Then, sir, I would come to the question of food grains, which is very important. Now, sir, these food grains imports went on, and as you know, 1 million tons of food grains cost us roughly about ₹5,000 crores. In the 12th five-year plan project, even we envisage 6 million tons of food grains being imported, and you can easily understand how much money it should cost. Every year we are losing so much foreign exchange because the food production does not measure up to the needs of our country. Today, sir, one should have thought that the government should make much more vigorous efforts to increase the food production, and for this purpose, it is absolutely essential to go into the question of land reforms. Unless and until land is distributed among the peasants, especially among the poorer sections of agricultural laborers and peasants, you can never turn the corner. We have seen how in China, in a matter of few years, they have been able to solve the food problem, and there is no difficulty with regard to foreign exchange there. We should have been a self-sufficient country by, according to the Prime Minister, but we are in the darkness, and there is no knowing as to when India is going to be self-sufficient. Our manpower and other resources are so abundant that it is quite possible by a little reorganization of our agricultural and land relations that we can turn the corner. Here again, sir, we are losing. Therefore, sir, the foreign exchange position has to be viewed from the angle of our entire economy. The crisis today has come about in that way. Then again, sir, our balance of payments position has been deteriorating year after year. It is no use trying to tell that it is not so. It is no use trying to point to a particular year when our balance of payments position had slightly improved. Everyone knows what is our balance of payments position. Therefore, sir, I think that in all spheres, the government's policies stand condemned and indicted by the people. Therefore, a very drastic change is necessary in the government policies. Now, sir, I would like to make a few suggestions. I know the difficulty that is there, but there should not be any panic about it. No quarter should be given to the slogan. Then, sir, with regard to sterling balances, there is another problem. I need not give any figures, but I only submit to the House that I do not think that it is essential to tie the Indian rupee to the sterling, nor do we require any currency reserve of that kind. Mr. V.K.R.V. Rao, the Vice Chancellor of the Delhi University, I am told, has expressed the same view. And since our rupee is fairly stable, since India has a developed economy, since our credit worthiness in the markets of the world is not bad, why must we tie our rupee to the sterling and require this kind of currency reserve? I do not see any need at all or maintaining a sterling reserve. Many countries do not need such reserves and do not keep such reserves. Even today, why must we do that? Then, sir, some change is necessary in our exchange banking system so that financing of our foreign trade could be done in a manner which conforms to the Indian interest and helps in augmenting our foreign exchange resources. In that connection, sir, I would particularly stress the need for breaking monopolies in the matter of foreign trade to which I had earlier referred. Today, it is essential for tourism to give proper direction to our trade according to the needs and the requirements of our economy. At the same time, we should try to develop our trade with those countries where such a trade remains with the state sector in the socialist countries. Malpractices of all kinds should be checked. Then, sir, remittances of profits abroad should be restricted, if not altogether stopped. Every time that we make this suggestion, we are told that will frighten away the foreign investor. We do not want other capitalists from abroad should come and invest money in our country and exploit cheap labor and make profits. All that we want is that loans should be obtained, if possible, at the government to government level so that we can meet the needs of our economy. That is how things should be viewed. Therefore, I say that we can certainly stop these remittances abroad and turn them to the use of the nation for developing our country's economy. After all, economic reconstruction of Egypt is not paralyzed and broken because President Nasir has taken over the Suez Canal. We have the example of Egypt, which by nationalizing the Suez Canal and inflicting a blow upon the British and French interests, has assured the rapid development of her economy.